Hey guys, welcome to the second episode of The Breakdown. So in this week's episode, we're going to work through three questions, really focusing on highlighting and trying to kind of talk through and eliminate some unnecessary highlighting. So with that, let's get started. So like I mentioned last week, the first thing I always do is I read the last sentence first. So let's take a look. Okay. And here, when I'm reading the last sentence, again, I don't want to highlight this whole thing. I just want to highlight, you know, the things that tell me what I'm looking for. So I'm looking for the bone marrow is going to show me what in regards to what this patient has. So that's all I need to know, that this is a bone marrow that I'm trying to see what is going to happen. So 6-year-old boy, whenever there's an age and then a sex, I always highlight that just because, you know, certain things are more prevalent in different age groups, and same thing for different, you know, male or female, child, adult. Things are just always different. One thing I typically highlight, and you can uncheck it if it ends up being not that important, is just the time frame, because some things are acute and some things are chronic. So anything 4 weeks or longer is chronic, and anything, you know, that's before 4 weeks is by definition acute. Okay, so these next couple sentences here. So conjunctival pallor, again, kind of nonspecific, grayish brown spots on the iris. So that's something very specific. Right here, they're trying to describe brush field spots. So that's specific for Down syndrome, prominent epicanthal folds, single transverse palmar crease. So all this, you know, these two whole sentences here are just trying to tell me that this child has Down syndrome. So for me, instead of highlighting all of this, I'm just going to highlight one key aspect of that that's going to tell me Down syndrome. So when I come back to read this later on, if I'm going to review this question, I'm going to see, I have a young boy, you know, something possibly chronic. Oh, he has Down syndrome. You know, what should my bone marrow look like? So let's just double check here to see if there's anything else. So scattered petechiae, this is just telling us anytime you have petechiae, you have thrombocytopenia, and typically it's less than 50,000. That's when you'll see petechiae, so little pinpoint red spots. So he also has enlarged liver and spleen, and based on our answer options, they're asking us about a type of cancer here. So we have a translocation, cluster of plasma cells, CD10. These all seem like cancer or some type of, you know, bone marrow problem. So what will the bone marrow of a young child with Down syndrome look like? And they're trying to pinpoint us to some type of cancer based on this and based on everything we've highlighted here in this stem. So one thing to keep in mind is that Down syndrome patients are about 10 to 20 times more likely to get the acute lymphocytic leukemia and then the acute myelogenous leukemia. So for kids, they're way more likely to get the B-ALL, so the B lymphocyte acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So we're looking for that is what I'm guessing here. So translocation of the 15-17. So this is the acute promyelogenous leukemia. So promyelogenous just means that this is kind of the pre-cell to the myelogenous cell. So myelogenous is a fancy word for granulocytes. And that will be things like your neutrophils. So the white blood cells that have granules in them. So this is out. Cluster of plasma cells. So this is describing multiple myeloma. So this is a good example of why we highlight the age. Multiple myeloma is extremely, extremely rare in children. So we would be looking for an older person in this stem. Ringed sideroblast. I mean, I think they would have to tell us more in this stem for that to be the case. One, I don't think it's associated with Down syndrome. And two, when I think of this, I'm thinking, you know, maybe they have a defect in heme. So, you know, lead poisoning, they have a synthase problem. And I don't think that is associated with Down syndrome. CD10, so CD10 is a marker for B cells. So how I try to remember this is CD1 to CD9 are T cell markers. CD10, CD19, CD20, those are B cell markers. And we said that children with Down syndrome are more likely to have the B cell acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So this should be our answer, but let's just double check with E here. So hypocellular bone marrow. So we have a bone marrow with no cells in it. When I think of this, I'm thinking, you know, myelodysplastic syndrome, where the bone marrow just becomes very fibrotic. There's no red marrow in there to have hematopoiesis. And the other cancer I think of would be like hairy cell leukemia, where you get what's known as a dry tap. And a dry tap is essentially saying the same thing. Our bone marrow is very fibrotic. So this should be out. Those two things really happen. Hairy cell leukemia, again, age group is typically in older people. Myelodysplastic syndrome, I don't think has any relation to Down syndrome. So I think our best answer is D, because we're looking for that B cell lymphoblastic leukemia. Okay, good. All right, next question. Let's read our last sentence first. So we're looking for the cause of this patient's symptoms. And what I didn't mention in the last question, but something I always do, is I do look at, you know, all my answer options first. This just kind of gauges me to what question this is. So an example, that one would have been, you know, maybe an immunology cancer question. This one seems very GI related. So this is a type of GI question. So 21-year-old woman, again, age and sex. Anytime I see middle-aged woman, the first thing that comes to my mind is, you know, autoimmune disease. 2-month history, so we have some kind of chronic illness. Fatigue, intermittent abdominal pain. So let's take a minute to stop here. So fatigue, intermittent abdominal pain, headaches, those are very nonspecific. So I don't typically highlight things that are very nonspecific, because they don't lead me to anything, you know, to any type of diagnosis right away. I'm looking for more specific findings or narrowed down topics. So bulky, foul-smelling diarrhea. What this tells me is we have some type of steatorrhea. So there's malabsorption and fat is being lost in the stool, and that's why we get that foul smell. So she is having weight loss. Anytime I see weight loss, especially over a short period of time, I'm highlighting it. This is a big indicator sometimes for cancer. Okay, this sentence right here, staining of the stool with Sudan 3, it's also called Sudan Black, shows a large number of red droplets. So we could highlight this too, but for me, this doesn't really give me a whole lot of extra information, because I know that if she's having bulky, foul-smelling stools, you know, that's steatorrhea, which means she's going to have lipids in the stool. Sudan Black or Sudan 3 showing us a large number of red droplets means that there's a lot of lipid or fat in this stool, which we already knew from up above. So I probably wouldn't highlight that, because if I come back to this question now, maybe I've saved 2 to 3 seconds just by not highlighting that whole sentence there. So what would we see in a middle-aged woman who has a bunch of fat in her stool? What one of these diseases correlates with that? So just starting with A, ulcerative colitis. So for this, I'm thinking pain with defecation. I'm thinking bloody stools. Carcinoid syndrome. So this is a type of cancer. And what happens is the cells secrete serotonin. So this gives us secretory diarrhea. Another thing that we would actually see with carcinoid too, we'd be looking for women with flushing, maybe a little bit of tachycardia, shortness of breath. C, amoebiasis. So Entamoeba histologica is what comes to my mind here. And that is also bloody stool. So that one's out. IBS. So IBS, I'm always looking for somebody who has pain that is relieved with defecation. Also some type of relation, you know, with food. Like I eat, I get an upset stomach, and then I go to the bathroom and my pain is gone. Lactose intolerance. So how I always think of this is kind of like glucose. Lactose is osmotically active. So this gives me an osmotic diarrhea, meaning lactose will pull water with it, similar to how glucose does, and my stool will be very, very watery. So celiac disease, just because we knew we eliminated all these, we don't even need to know what celiac disease is, we could get this question correct. But celiac disease will affect the duodenum, and what we'll see is you're going to get fat malabsorption because those areas, you know, they're not absorbing. So what we're going to have is loss of fat soluble vitamins, more fat in the stool, and then we're going to get that stinky foul smell. And this is a big thing too right here, this villus atrophy. When we damage the little villi, those do our absorption. So if we can't absorb, we're going to have malabsorption, we're going to lose fat, and we're going to get that stinky stool. So last question, let's start with our last sentence first. Which is my... So we're looking for the pathogenesis of this condition. Pathogenesis, so just what is the process of how we get this disease? Anytime I have an image with a question, I look at it first, because if I can tell what disease this is just based on the image, you know, maybe I've saved myself 60 seconds because I don't have to read the whole stem. So this image, these look like Burr cells to me. There is another name, but I never memorized that. So Burr cells, they have these spikes all along the red blood cell membrane. And these spikes are kind of equidistant to each other. So they go all around, you know, it's not just on one side. So this is a Burr cell. Typically when I see Burr cell, I'm thinking, you know, maybe pyruvate kinase deficiency. So let's just take a look and we'll go through here. So we have a newborn male. The woman is Rh positive. So right off the bat, we can eliminate this, the rhesus antigen. So maternal antibodies against the rhesus antigen. You have to have an Rh negative mother for this to be correct. And she is Rh positive. So she will not make antibodies against Rh if she is Rh positive. So what happens is an Rh negative mother has a child, their first child is Rh positive. And then the Rh positive baby blood will mix with the mother. So go through the placenta and mix with the mother's blood. And then the mom makes antibodies, so Rh antibodies against the Rh positive baby. So when she has the second baby, those antibodies will go through the placenta and start to attack the baby. And what you can see is hydrops fatalis. So because she's Rh positive, once again, this cannot be true. So we have a newborn with fever. Whenever I see newborn with fever, the first thing that comes to my mind is possibly sepsis, because until you rule it out, that's just always what it is. So we have some yellow discoloration of the skin. So jaundice, fever, loss of flexion in the extremities. Splenomegaly. So something bad is going on here. That's all I'm getting. Okay, this is the money piece right here. Decreased haptoglobin levels and increased LDH levels. When you see decreased haptoglobin, haptoglobin binds hemoglobin, and it will go down if you have red blood cell lysis. So when we lyse the red blood cells, one, lactate dehydrogenase is released, so that goes up. And two, when the red blood cell lyses, our hemoglobin is released and it gets picked up and bound by haptoglobin. So our free haptoglobin level goes down. So all of this is telling me that this baby has some type of hemolytic anemia. And based on our image with the Burr cells, we would be looking for our pyruvate kinase deficiency. So I've just kind of memorized that pyruvate kinase goes with the Burr cell, but there is a little process to this because pyruvate kinase is the last step in glycolysis. We can't make ATP, the cell membrane of red blood cells becomes all wonky and we get those spikes. So D should be our answer, but let's go through here. Excuse me. So A, decrease in the reduced form of glutathione. So this would be G6PD deficiency. In our image, we would be looking for Heinz bodies and BiTE cells. So we did not see that. So this is out. Point mutation in beta globin. So this is sickle cell. We did not see, you know, a ton of sickle cells in this image. So maybe that looks like one, but the majority of this picture, I mean, we just see these Burr cells everywhere. So this one is out. I'm pretty sure that this one is our answer. Osmotically fragile erythrocytes. So this is screaming to me hereditary spherocytosis. So we would be looking for those perfectly round, you know, nice round red blood cells that just look perfect. And we don't see any of that. So this is out. And boom. So here, let's see, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, so because our pyruvate kinase converts to the PEP into pyruvate, we don't get 50% of the red blood cells ATP. Remember, red blood cells, they don't have organelles. So they only get glycolysis and oxidative phosphorylation as their way to generate ATP. So we get the first step with the rate limiting enzyme is of the phosphofructokinase, but we don't get that second step of phosphorylation with the pyruvate kinase. So instead of getting two ATP, we only get one every time. And that's a huge drain to our red blood cells. Because of this, we get a disturbance in this cation gradient and our red blood cell membrane leads to hemolysis. So one great thing about Amboss is if you need to review anything, I would bet money that there is an image to it or you can find it, you know, very, very quickly. So it's the phosphoglycerate kinase. This is the first step of oxidative phosphorylation where we're making ATP. And this is our second step of oxidative phosphorylation. So where we make our second ATP, because this enzyme no longer works, we only get one instead of two. That affects our red blood cell membrane. And then we get hemolysis. And with that, that is our second episode of the breakdown. For week three, we're going to be working on summarizing. So kind of taking the whole stem as a whole and figuring out a single one-liner for what is this question truly asking me. Sometimes stems, they have so much information that it's really tricky to figure out what it's actually asking me. But when we put it into a single sentence, sometimes it just makes more sense. So that's something we're going to work on next week. So if you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and please give me a like. If you didn't like this video, please give me some constructive criticism in the comments and I'll get back to you. Thank you.